Welcome to lecture 4 in our series. Today we are discussing strategy formulation. The previous lecture we were considering the first step of the process of strategic management, which is environmental scanning. So just as an introduction to what strategy formulation is all about, this is the development of long-term plans. The development of long-term plans for the effective management of the environmental elements. Remember, we emphasize the fact that the starting point in our process of strategic management is to know where you are, understanding your strategic position. And the easiest way to do that was to conduct a SWOT analysis. So with the strategy formulation now, we want to develop long-term plans that will help us effectively manage those environmental opportunities or threats in light of an organization's strengths and weaknesses. So it includes, number one, defining the mission. It's always important to get back to the mission. Remember earlier in the presentations, we were defining a mission as simply a reason why you are existing, a statement that defines your business. So before you can come up with any long-term plan, it's important to revisit the mission of an organization. Then the other thing that we do in our strategy formulation is to specify achievable objectives. Again, these objectives are things that we want to achieve, the end results, and we are guided by the SMART model, where we emphasize that our objectives must be specific, they must be measurable, they must be achievable, realistic, and then you set some time limit. So you get to the objectives as well. Then the third thing that you do, just as a guideline in your strategy formulation activity, is now to develop the strategies. And that's our focus in today's presentation, because we know what a mission is, we know what an objective is. We are now looking at the actual development of these strategies. We don't just end there. The last thing that you do as a guide in strategy formulation is to set policy guidelines. Now, policy guidelines, they help us in our decision making. We've been emphasizing from the onset that strategic management requires you as a person who is at the helm of an organization, the chief executive officer, to make strategic decisions. And as you make these decisions, we normally are guided by policies. So the last thing that we do is to set these policy guidelines so that we make very effective decisions and we are systematic in the way that we do things. Okay, so what is a strategy? Because we are formulating a strategy here. A strategy of any organization forms a comprehensive master plan. It's a comprehensive master plan that will state how an organization, a corporation, will achieve its objectives and fulfill its mission. So it's a master plan. Other authors have defined strategy as a managerial game plan. It's one thing to set objectives, which may be very inspiring. You may be very optimistic in setting those objectives, but it's also another thing to see to it that those objectives are achieved. So strategy comes in to ensure that you actually achieve those objectives that you have set. So it's a master plan that will clearly state how an organization will achieve its objective and fulfill its mission, which is the reason why you are doing business as an organization. Now, a well-crafted strategy will maximize competitive advantage. We've been emphasizing the concept of competitive advantage because all sectors are very competitive nowadays. There's no sector that is left out. So a well-crafted strategy helps you to maximize your competitive advantage. Any typical business firm will usually consider three types of strategy. We have what we call a corporate level strategy, we have a business level strategy, and a functional strategy. And in our step number two of strategy formulation, our focus will be on these three strategies. So we have corporate level, we have the business level strategies, and the functional strategy. So let's start with the first one, which is the corporate level strategy. Now, a corporate level strategy is a senior management's game plan. Remember, we mentioned earlier that a strategy is a game plan. Now, this is a game plan for senior executives, and particularly the chief executive and other senior executive officers. So it's a senior management's game plan that will direct how an organization is going to run as a whole. It's a master plan for an organization as a whole. At this level, friends, we are all aware that an organization would have what we call functional areas. There may be a unit that deals with production, another unit that will just deal with marketing related activities, another unit that will deal with finance and accounting, other unit may deal with procurement. Now, we are describing a master plan for the whole organization. Some scholars have described a corporate level strategy as an umbrella plan that encompasses all these other functional areas, because it clearly states how an organization is going to run. Now, this corporate level strategy will cut across all these functional areas that I just described. It will cut across all the functional areas, the different businesses, the product lines, and the technologies. Now, think of a company that is diversified. A company that may have so many strategic business units in their portfolio. So we are describing a plan for all these other units that fall under this company. Or it may be a company that has got so many product lines, like the likes of Trade Kings today. They have so many product lines. So we are talking about a plan that will encompass all these product lines under this one organization. So the task of developing or formulating this strategy called a corporate level strategy will usually involve three elements. The three elements that you consider as you develop a strategy at corporate level, which is the senior management's responsibility. So what are those three elements? Quickly, let's run through these. Number one, you must decide how you are going to manage the scope and the mix of the company's activities. Remember I said it is for senior management, at strategic level, top management, so you have to make decisions on how you are going to manage the mix and the scope of these activities that you are undertaking as a business. So you must develop a plan of how you are going to manage these activities. And the whole instance is to improve on corporate performance, the performance of an organization as a whole. So decide how you are going to manage these activities. Now, in managing these business activities or a portfolio, you really have to make decisions, for example, regarding how you're going to get into new businesses. Okay? A business may want to go into other lines of business, you may want to introduce a new product, you may want to go into other markets, new markets. So decisions must be made how you're going to enter into these new businesses, because a corporate level strategy will have to deal with all those issues. If you want to come out of certain businesses, maybe exit some of the existing businesses, again, decisions must be made. Do we do it quickly? Do we just stop producing this product? Do we just close this branch that is not profitable anymore? Again, decisions have to be made. In the recent past, we've heard a lot of stories, news items, where some businesses were just closing out some branches which were no longer profitable. Decisions have to be made. Do we just come out gradually, or should it be a quick process? And in, normally in business, a gradual process is recommended because you take care of the other stakeholders to that business. It's not only the owners of the business who want to get the profit from that business. Remember, you have your customers. Remember, you have the community. Remember, the government also is an interested party. They want to get tax revenues. So you decide when you're exiting some of these businesses, should it be a quick one or a gradual process? Again, as you do your element number one, trying to manage the various activities of an organization, it's important at that level to develop what we call a common strategic theme. So even if you have all these activities, the company may be diversified, you really need to have one common strategic theme that all these lines, companies, lines of businesses are pursuing. It's one organization. So step number one, or element number one, as you develop your corporate level strategy, which is a master plan for the whole organization, these decisions must be made. How you are going to manage these activities, how you are going to go into new businesses, and whether you are going to stop certain businesses, should you do it, you know, in a gradual process, or should it be a quick process? Then element number two, as you develop your corporate level strategy, is to provide for coordination of the different businesses in the portfolio. So providing for coordination of integrated activities to allow a diversified firms to do these two things. Think of a business like Zambif, okay? They have so many business portfolios. They have Zamleather, you can have Zamyug, you can have Zamanita, they're doing the oil and all those. So they must come up with a way or a technique of how they are going to coordinate all these businesses under one. From our knowledge in management, we know that coordination is a function of management. And coordination here simply entails synchronizing all these activities so that you all move in one direction. So it's important to provide for coordination so that you can enhance the competitive strength of the business units and make the corporate strategy more than just a collection of action plans. You want to operationalize this strategy. So coordination is very, very important when you are coming up with a corporate level strategy. So there must be provisions, mechanisms of how you are going to ensure that the different interrelated units of a business are well coordinated, or else other units of the business may be going in a different direction. That's why a common strategic theme is very, very critical, like we mentioned earlier. So element number two, other than just deciding how you're going to manage the activities, coordination is critical here. And again, there are four techniques that aid effective coordination from our knowledge in management. One of them, if you want to have effective coordination, is simply to constitute what we call committees. You may wonder, in organizations, you may have a financial controller, finance director, but why do we still have finance committees, budget committees? These committees just help to actually bring the ideas together, pull the resources together, and come up with very good recommendations. So committees help us to coordinate, even in our social lives. I know most of you are members of various committees at church, in the neighborhood, at clubs. Those committees, when people meet together, they plan an event, there is coordination. In the absence of committees, you may not have effective coordination. Another technique you can use in coordination is simply coming up with regular meetings, you know, staff meetings, because during a meeting, you put your ideas together and you discuss. The other one is coming up with schedules, timetables, when certain activities should be completed. And those schedules, the Gantt charts that you learn in statistics, they just help you to monitor the activities when they are going to be done, so that you are more systematic. That helps us to be more coordinated in the way that we do things. Okay, then the third element, I said there are three elements when you're developing a corporate level strategy, is to establish what we call investment priorities. Now remember, I don't want you to lose the picture. We are developing a master plan for the whole organization, an umbrella plan for the whole organization. You may have 3, 4, 5 strategic business units or your portfolios in that organization. You may have this line, maybe, like I gave an example, Zambif, you may have Zamleda here, you may have Zamanita here, you may have Zamchik there. So how do you ensure that you have investment priorities? That is very, very key as you develop that strategic plan at that level. So you must decide, when it comes to establishing investment priorities, decide how you are going to spend your resources. Resources are scarce. We are told in economics that we are in a society where there are scarce resources and you have a lot of competing demands for the limited resources that you have. So investment priorities and a pattern of corporate resource allocation is very, very critical here. So what do we mean there? As a strategic leader, you must channel most of your resources out of areas where earnings potentials are lower into areas where earning potentials are higher, because the resources are limited. From our BCG matrix, a model that helps us to manage our portfolio, Bruce Anderson, the one who developed the matrix for the Boston Consulting Group, classified business units or products into 4 categories. You may have a star, you may have a question mark, you may have a cash cow, and a dog. Now, that matrix just helps us in terms of investment decisions. Where do we commit most of our resources? Do we put most of the resources in this business, a product which is struggling on the market? Meanwhile, it is in a market where the industry is growing very fast. Maybe there may be a problem with a product. Or do we put money in a product or a business unit like a dog whose market share is low and is also operating in an industry that is growing at a very slow rate? So those questions are very critical as you establish your investment decisions. You want to channel most of the resources in those business units or areas where your earnings potentials are higher. Then you have to also ensure that you make decisions in terms of portfolio management, which businesses do you bring on board and which ones do you stop, you know, operating in. That is very, very critical. So those elements are key as you develop a corporate level strategy. So we have discussed the first one, which is corporate level strategy. We know the managers that are responsible for this strategy. These are senior executives. And as you develop that strategy, 3 things that you must consider: how you are going to manage the scope of these activities, how you are going to provide for coordination of all these activities, and establishing investment priorities and the resource allocation, you know, pattern. But the next level of strategies is what we call the business level strategy, number 2. Now, this usually occurs at the business unit or a product level. away from the whole organization. A corporate level strategy, remember I said, is for the whole organization. I'll give an example of a business you are familiar with, an institution you are familiar with, which is your own university, the University of Lusaka. So when you are developing a corporate strategy, it's a strategy for the whole five schools of the university, because this plan will describe or state how the university as a whole is going to run. But when we get to a business level strategy, we are now at a unit of a university or a product level. Maybe in this case, it may be a strategy for one specific school of the university. Say, for example, the School of Business. You are coming up with a strategy just for that school, not for the whole organization. So this is a difference that we get. Or it may be a strategy for one particular product that you are offering as an institution. Now, what's the purpose of this business level strategy? Or why? Where is the emphasis, the focus? This strategy emphasizes improvement of the competitive position of a company's product or services in a specific industry or a market segment that is served by that business unit. So if we go back to the Unilas example, a school of business may come up with a business level strategy that will make the school of business to be more competitive. To be more competitive here, maybe in Lusaka, where we are as a university, because that's where we are drawing the students or our clients to this university. So the emphasis of a business level strategy is to improve on the competitiveness of a particular unit. Whereas the corporate level strategy, the emphasis, we say, is to improve on the corporate performance of an organization as a whole. Now, most of these business strategies may fit within two broad categories of competitive or cooperative strategies. We'll focus more on the competitive strategies and I'll explain later. So these competitive strategies include a differentiation strategy, a cost leadership strategy, and a market focus strategy. A quick run through these strategies, you have them in the notes, but I just want to give you some pointers, areas of emphasis, and you can read more to get more understanding from your notes. So what is product differentiation as a business level strategy? An example of one strategy at a business level, and remember we said that this strategy helps you to improve on your competitive position. Now, product differentiation is a strategy that involves creating a difference. You want to create a difference from your rivals, and you want your customers to see that difference. The difference must be valued by the customers. Again, friends, we have reached times where most businesses are basically offering the same services, the same products. The key question is, what will make customers go for your product and not your competitor's product? I gave an example of the School of Business at Unilas. If you're developing a business level strategy, what will make customers come to our school and pursue a degree in accountancy, in human resource, in business admin, in economics, a degree which is offered by several other universities? It's how you provide your service. It's how you differentiate your product from your competitors. So we'll look at product differentiation, which simply entails creating a difference, and that difference must be valued by your customers. So how do you create a difference? The difference could be, for example, in the area of the procurement of materials. There are some organizations, business organizations, that emphasize whenever they are getting inputs for their production processes or the business activities they undertake, they emphasize that they will only get They are inputs from original sources, not secondary sources. Some companies will even tell you, if you are a supplier, you want to get business, they will tell you, we only get items from registered suppliers, and for you to be registered as a supplier, you meet a lot of requirements. They may ask for ISO certification. Do your products meet international standards, for example? So you can create a difference in your procurement processes by ensuring that you get products that are from original sources. Again, you can create a difference in your production processes, just the way you produce your product. I've always wondered and asked questions. Why is an outlet, a restaurant, eating place like Angry Lion attract so many customers? And yet, they're just in the business of offering, producing the chicken and chips. Chicken and chips, you get it from many places, even in our homes. But what makes Angry Lion's chicken and chips different from the others? And many customers I've interacted with, they make references to the spice that is put in their chips. You know, even if you are not there, you may not be in a room, and when somebody buys chicken and chips and they start eating, you actually get that nice aroma from their chicken and chips. So they've created a difference in their production processes. And you can tell that this is Angry Lion, this is not Angry Lion. So you can differentiate in your production processes, in the product design, for example, in terms of the packaging, you have attractive features, and that will make you to be more competitive than others. You may also create a difference in your marketing processes. Your product branding, the brand name, the logo that you have, the way you advertise your products, the appearance of your product, the packaging of your product, make the product is user-friendly, and many customers will just get attracted by that. So through your marketing processes, you can also create a difference. Now remember, all these strategies, the three strategies, have their own pitfalls or risks of pursuing such a strategy. A notable pitfall for product differentiation is that your competitors may just copy your innovations, your attractive features, and they may try to do it far much better. Okay? And not only that, you may spend so much money, invest more money in trying to create a difference, and that may defeat the purpose of doing business because the investment may be too much compared to the benefit that you want to get. So there are all these pitfalls in these strategies, but it's important to understand that whenever you want to do product differentiation, you are basically trying to create a difference from your rivals and want that difference to be valued by your customers. The difference may be just in improved quality. There are customers who are moved by quality, we've mentioned this several times, and they are prepared to spend more money as long as they get a quality product. So if your quality is improved and customers value that, you can create a difference. The other example of a business level strategy is a market focus. Now, this one simply entails identifying a particular segment of the market. For those of you that did principles of marketing, BCM 210, you will remember topics like the STP process, segmentation, targeting, and positioning. There's a lot of emphasis nowadays in business to identify specific target market and just concentrate on that market. So you want to cater to a narrower or limited segment of the market, rather than going for an approach we call a something for everyone approach. You can't be good in all areas. So market focus is about identifying a particular segment of the total market and concentrate on that segment so that you become a leader. But how to segment the market? They are what we call bases of segmentation, and the following are just some of them. Number one, you can segment the market on the basis of demographic variables or socioeconomic characteristics like age, gender, education. You agree with me that the age of an individual will, to a very large extent, influence your preferences, what you buy or what you like, even in terms of your tastes. When you give a young person, a kid, some money, you tell the kid, there's some money for you, what can I buy you? They'll probably ask you to buy them ice cream, jiggies, that's what they like. And what is influencing their choice is the age. You ask an elderly person, there's some 100 kwacha here for you, what can I buy for you? That elderly person will ask you to give them. Maybe they may even buy Zesco units or other more important things. So the age influences what you buy. So you may segment and come up with a product that will just appeal to the elderly people, or a product that will appeal to the young ones, product that will appeal maybe the youths. Or you may segment on the basis of education. People that are learned, that are educated, would have certain preferences, products that they may prefer, compared to those that may have a lower level education. Another basis could be purchase, the size. You know, there are customers that buy in bulk. You may segment on the basis of application, or is it industrial market, consumer market, or you may just want to save the government institutions. There are some businesses that just survive on saving the government. They are not in a hurry to go in the private sector. So they have segmented and found that market to be more attractive in terms of profits. You may also use geographic variable, where you segment the market on the basis of cities or territories or regions. There are some businesses that may just be in one area of a country. Say, for example, in Zambia, this business may just be Livingstone, and they are not even in a hurry to go in other provinces. They have segmented the market and they are more comfortable with Livingstone. They found it to be more attractive, and that may be their target market. So that is about market focus. Again, like I said, before we get to the next one, a market focus strategy will have some risks associated with that strategy. And one of the major risks of that strategy is that if you identify a particular segment and you concentrate on that segment, other players, rival organizations or competitors may actually identify that you're making a lot of money in that segment, may just come in and identify other smaller segments within that segment. Or they may just come and take over and offer customers a good service or more products that will make you lose out. And if you just concentrated in that area, then your business will be threatened. Okay, the third one, like I said, there are three under business level strategy, is a cost leadership strategy. Now, what is a cost leadership strategy? This is a strategy that involves producing goods or services with features that are attractive or acceptable to the customers, but at the lowest cost relative to that of your competitors. That is a cost strategy. So you produce a product or a service whose features, attributes are acceptable by customers. You are not compromising on the quality, but you're producing this product at the lowest cost relative to your competitors. That's a cost leadership strategy. Now, normally firms that pursue a cost leadership strategy, they normally sell standardized goods or services to the industry's most typical customers. So you're selling or producing standardized products. They may not be products that are very unique with innovative features. They are standard products, but you want to produce them at the lowest cost when you compare with your competitors. So what is key or critical in pursuing this strategy is to make sure that your processes, the innovations that you have, the production methods, distribution methods and techniques must be up to date so that they are more critical, and this will help you to be successful in your cost leadership strategy. The whole idea is not to compromise on quality. And that's why the emphasis here is that the products, the services must be of features that are acceptable to your customers. The only thing that you are going to do is try to produce these same products at a lowest cost than your competitors. Now, these cost leaders or companies that pursue a cost leadership strategy, they concentrate on finding ways to lower their costs. They concentrate very much. They want to find ways of lowering their costs. And normally, they will lower their costs either in the area of procurement, in the area of production processes, and in the area of marketing and distribution. What they normally do is conduct what we call a strategic cost analysis, which is an assessment of the makeup of all the costs from procurement, production, sales and distribution, up to the final product that you're offering to the customer in terms of price. So most companies engage in what we call backward integration and forward integration. These are very important concepts, again, in strategic management. I'll give an example of a business organization that quickly comes to my mind, and this is ShopRite. Now, ShopRite, they have even coined their slogan, crafted their slogan by saying, lower prices always. And one wonders why ShopRite has stayed here for a very long time. When they came in the mid-90s, there were other businesses that came almost at the time with ShopRite, like Supreme Furnitures, Smart Center, those of you that were there. Remember all those businesses, iFi Corp, but most of them went back to South Africa. ShopRite is still here. They have worked on their price. And what they've done is that they make sure that where they get their product, their material, they get most of their merchandise from manufacturers. Watch most of their documentaries on TV whenever they're advertising. They try to cut down on the middlemen or the intermediaries. So when they get direct from the manufacturers, they eliminate the profits that a chameo or a wholesaler would have made on top, and they will get the items at a cheaper cost, so that their selling price also will be relatively lower. So that's what we call backward integration, where you take care of the supply side of your inputs into your processes. Or you can also integrate forward, is what we call forward integration, where you take care of the distribution channels, like the way Zambia has done. They have their own ranches, they grow their own cattle, they have their own outlets where they sell the items. So they take care of all these costs, and that way your products will be relatively lower. So these cost leaders, they concentrate on finding ways of how they can lower their costs. They rethink how to complete their primary and support activities to reduce costs further while maintaining competitive levels of differentiation. Remember, even when you are pursuing a low cost strategy, or cost leadership strategy, never compromise on the quality. You must always maintain a certain level of differentiation so that it's not just about a lower price, but you also maintain the quality of the product. So effective use of the cost leadership strategy allows the firm to earn above average returns in spite of the presence of strong competitive forces. So you earn above average returns. Remember, the whole idea of these strategies is to improve the competitive position of the firm. And in our understanding of the strategic management process, we are saying most companies use this process as a foundation upon which they make decisions, they take actions as they pursue strategic competitiveness and earn above average returns. So yes, when this strategy works for you, the cost leadership strategy will allow you as a firm to earn above average returns because you remain competitive in your industry. The third strategy, which is the last one, I said there are three, is what we call a functional strategy. So we have discussed corporate level strategy, the business level strategy, where we have those three: product differentiation, market focus, cost leadership strategy. The third one is the functional strategy. Now, this is the approach taken by a functional area to achieve corporate and business unit objectives. Now, functional strategies aim to maximize what we call resource productivity. The whole idea of a functional strategy is to maximize resource productivity. How do you utilize the resources in an organization? So it's about optimal utilization of the resources in this business. And that's why it's done at a functional area, at an operational area. Others will call them operating strategies. How you utilize your resources. Now, dear friends, in modern management, there's a lot of emphasis on efficiency and effectiveness. If you are going to be a manager that is not efficient, you waste resources, you do not achieve stated objectives, the owners of the business may not be pleased with you, and they may give you the way out of that organization. Why? Like we keep saying, resources are scarce. So you don't want to come up with a strategy that will make you waste your resources. You must maintain that level of productivity. When we talk of productivity, we are basically looking at the ratio of your input to the output. So it is concerned with developing and nurturing a distinctive competence to provide a company or a business unit with a competitive advantage. So business firms normally in practice will use all these three types of strategies simultaneously. So they will use these strategies simultaneously, which is the corporate level strategy, the business level, and the functional level strategy. So what have I said before we just get to the last slide of our presentation? What we are saying here, friends, is that we have these three levels of strategy. At corporate level, it is called a comprehensive master plan, senior management game plan that enables you to come up with a plan of how you are going to run an organization as a whole. At business level, we are now focusing on an SBU, a business unit, or a product, level. How do we improve the competitive position of this unit? That's the business level strategy. The focus of the business level strategy is to improve on the competitive position of that unit. At functional level, we are saying we are now concerned with how we are utilizing the resources at a functional area. We want to maximize resource productivity. That's why I was talking about issues of efficiency. We'll end our presentation on the hierarchy of strategy. The hierarchy of strategy. Now, a hierarchy of strategy is the grouping of strategy types by level in the organization. We want to group these strategies by level. Hierarchy is like a pyramid. You go up, So we want to group these strategies by level. That's what a hierarchy of strategies simply means. So at times, most students just get intimidated by terminologies. You know, when you are told to explain what a hierarchy of strategy is, people find it very difficult. A hierarchy of strategy is simply the grouping of strategy types or by level in the organization. Which one is on the top, which one follows, and which one is at the bottom. That's what a hierarchy of strategy entails. So this hierarchy of strategy is a nesting of one strategy within another so that they complement and support one another. Remember I was saying at times you can have these strategies pursued, you know, simultaneously. So you want to create an environment where these strategies can actually complement and support one another. So don't have a corporate strategy just in isolation, business strategy in another direction, functional strategy in another direction. No, friends, they must complement each other and support each other. What do we mean by that? So functional strategies, which are at a lower level, where we are trying to maximize resource productivity, they support the business level strategies that follow. The business level strategies in turn will feed into the corporate level strategies. Because going back to the example I gave, a school of business as a unit under the University of Lusaka cannot just have a strategy by its own that does not feed into the master plan of the organization as a whole. And that's what we mean. So the business level strategies must feed into the corporate level strategies. Just like strategies at your lowest level, at operational level, must also support the business level strategies. Now, just as many firms do not have formally stated objectives, again, we discover that in terms of strategies, many firms may not have strategies that they have clearly stated and articulated or even analyzed. Even at an individual level, there are very few of us that maybe have time to write our plans, our ambitions, and what we want to achieve in life. Most of those plans are just in the minds. So even in some organizations, you'll find that companies may not have these strategies well articulated and analyzed. But as a strategist, I want to encourage you to have these strategies formally stated, articulated, and analyzed. Why? Because they are the means that you're going to use to achieve your objectives. Strategies are the means that you're going to use to fulfill the mission of an organization. In lecture 5, we'll discuss another type of strategy to do with mergers and acquisitions, and then from there we'll move on to implementation of strategy. I thank you all for your attention.